people are in here yet, but I'm going to go ahead and give the announcements. Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. I'm Melinda Moniz, for those who may not know me. I was up here a couple weeks ago. You may be getting tired of seeing me. So I'm giving the announcements for today, and one of the ones that I'm really pushing is something that's near and dear to my heart because I'm the chairman of our Stepping Stones daycare. And there's a flyer in the bulletin. We are having a spruce up day tomorrow over at Stepping Stones. If you like to clean or paint or organize, it's probably a great event for you. I have a sign-up sheet that I'm going to circulate. I circulated it a couple weeks ago. So if you've already signed up, you don't have to put your name on again. But if you believe that you can give some time to the daycare, we'd really appreciate it. Right now I only have 13 volunteers and we need about 20. It's broken up so that there's two shifts. You can come in from 9:30 to 1, or 1 to 4:30. Or if you want to stay all day, that would be wonderful. We'd love to have you. If you do plan on coming, I ask for some information here. I'll send a reminder email tonight. But if you happen to have, you know, gloves or things you want to wear, you know, we'll have cleaning supplies. But if there's things like that, please feel free to bring them. So that's the one that I'm really, really pushing. Also, Chip is going to begin tomorrow at 3 o'clock. There is a information registration session. It will be in the fellowship hall. So for those who have signed up or are interested, please be here for 3 o'clock. And if you have questions, feel free to ask Marge Hay. I saw her earlier. I don't know, she might still be out in the vestibule. There is a Ohio Conference Elementary Music Festival that's going to be on April 8th at 3:30 at the Kettering Church, for those who might be interested. And also, there's a flyer also in an insert in the bulletin for the Mom's Breakfast, which is 10 o'clock on Sabbath, April 22nd. Please be sure that you read through the bulletin, and there's a lot of announcements up here in front as well. Kids choir, the next practice actually is today. And let's see if there's anything else that's immediate. I don't think so. Did you have anything specific? Okay, so that is all I have. If anyone else has something, you know, you could raise your hand and I can let you come up. Otherwise, please look for the clipboard that will be passed around, and Bob Bradley is going to lead us in our opening prayer. No, opening song. Sorry, opening song, not prayer. Hey, Bob. Bob. Hey, Bob.
Yes. Are we ready?
Yep, you're ready.
Okay.
Before we sing, I'd like to tell the gentleman upstairs our closing hymn is going to be hymn 338, as opposed to the one that's in the bulletin. Hymn 338, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. All right, everyone, good morning, happy Sabbath. It's time to stand up, shake hands, and then we're going to sing together. But everybody stand and shake hands together. Meet somebody new today, tell them you love them, and invite someone else to church. What you have on is a closing hymn. As you get back to your seats, our morning hymn, hymn 579, 'Tis Love That Makes Me Happy. I'm sorry, wrong. Yeah, the wonder of it all. I'm sorry, I flipped to the wrong page. Everyone with me.
There's a wonder of sunshine at evening, the wondrous sunrise I see. But the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me.
Everyone sing it.
Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, is just to think that God loved me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me.
Lady, all, only on this stand. Come on, ladies. Sing it out, ladies. Everyone now in the chorus. Okay, let's repeat the first stanza, and the men will sing with me. Everyone, or it's men.
There's a wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder in sunrise I see, but the wonder of wonder that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me.
Everyone now.
Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me.
Please be seated. Thank you.
As far as you are able, please kneel with me for prayer this morning. Father in heaven, we come to you this morning here in Worthington, grateful for the safety that you brought to us this week, but also mindful of those who have had very difficult times this week, Lord. We know that right now that the Adventist University in Peru is suffering devastating flooding, as is much of the country, Lord. And we pray for our brothers and sisters at the church there on the campus, as well as those that are around in the city of Ñaña, real near the Adventist Union University in Peru. Please bless them and touch their hearts and know that they are loved and a part of the global church, Lord, this morning. Father, we thank you so much for the chance to be here and for those watching at home and listening on the internet, Lord. Thank you for all those that have chosen to worship today with our church here in Worthington. Father, I know that there are those today that couldn't be here because of illness or because they are far away from home. I pray all those that are sick and unable to attend today would receive a Sabbath blessing, and that you would make your spirit known to them this morning, this day, and they would receive the blessing of your Sabbath. Lord, we don't know what's going to come our way this week. You do, but we don't. I pray that no matter what is in store, that we would remember that we are Christians, Lord, and that we live the example of Christ to those around us every day, and for many, many unbelieving people, Lord. We are the arms, the feet, the hands of the church, of your body, Lord. Please help us to reach out to our friends and loved ones and demonstrate your kindness and love to them so that they can be touched in a way that is meaningful to them and so they can understand just a piece of the love that you would have them have. Thank you for the knowledge of salvation and this beautiful, wonderful church to worship in this morning. Amen. You may be seated. Before we have the deacons come forward, Ben, would you mind to pull up my quick little PowerPoint, if that's all right? I wanted to share with you all a report from the Health Ministries Department of our church. I think many of you are aware, and were physically present last week for the 10TV Health and Fitness Expo, the Commit to Be Fit, that happened downtown or near the fairgrounds last week. We have a few pictures I wanted to share with you. We saw 600 people that came through our health fair at the fairgrounds. That is by far the largest outreach that our church does in the calendar year. You can see our church banner is prominently displayed there. You can see Julian and I getting ready to start the day. You can see the Babcock's hard at work there. And we had volunteers, the nurse sitting there next to me doing cholesterol screenings is a nurse from the James where I work in the intensive care unit. And then you can see there's Doris working hard. It was a real blessing. We saw 400 people on the first day and 200 people on the second day. So many, many hearts and hands were touched by our church members and the volunteers from not just our church, but from several of the churches here in Central Ohio. I'm personally grateful, as is the rest of Health Ministries, to all of you who volunteered. This is a huge event, and I am grateful, and I think that the pastoral staff would also say they are grateful for your time, your dedication, your service to reaching out to the community and serving with at this event. I want to call out a couple people just especially to say thank you to Kennedy Dulo for helping us with water procurement and delivery, and Dan Howard for the use of his van and his services as we went down to load the event in. Rafi and others helped us unload the event and bring it back here to the church. So thank you to all of you. I'm, like I said, very grateful. That's true. That's true. If you want to hear a story about a tarantula and the pastor and Doris, come by later, and I'm sure one of them will share that with you from the health fair. I asked this time if the deacons would please come forward. As the deacons come forward, let's bow our heads one more time, and we will bless our tithes and offerings. Father in heaven, thank you so much for a chance to give back just a piece to you of what is yours. I pray that you would bless these tithes and offerings. Continue to bless the finances of our church, Lord. May we continue to use the dollars that are donated to this church to service you and to spread your word to the community and to be a bright light on a hill. Amen. Thank you.
Very nice, Roger. I'm here, but the choir isn't. The first time in 15 years we've had to cancel because we didn't have enough singers. That's not an accusation. That's not questioning the commitment of the choir members. It's the reality of life. We've talked since the beginning of forming 15 years ago that nothing lasts, so we have to be ready for all kinds of changes, and we've adapted very well. At the peak of the choir's life a few years ago, we had 28 to 30 members. Now we have about 17 to 19 members. And we found out this week that three members, parents are having critical health crises, would not be here, and will be probably preoccupied with parental care for the coming months. And then we had family commitments that took three other people away. And when you only have 17 to 19 people, it just doesn't leave you with enough singers. So I'm coming to you asking you to search your heart if you always have enjoyed singing and can sing a harmony part, and you'd be willing to participate with us for two weekends a month, pretty much. It's usually the first and third weekend. We rehearse the Friday night before we sing. And I think you would find it it's a fun community, the singing community, and when you sing together, it creates a bond that's very special. In addition to creating, I think, some wonderful music. Now, I drive 2.5 hours round trip to be here. And I know for me, it'll become very hard for me to make that trip not knowing whether or not we're gonna have a group here to sing. But I also know the fragility of volunteer groups, that if you're not punctual, if you're not predictable, it'll fade very quickly because people won't give up their Friday nights and Saturday mornings if it can't be something they can rely on. So I'm sharing that with all of you. Maybe we've maxed out our potential in terms of singers with our congregation. I noticed the active numbers of members on a Saturday morning has not been what it was when the choir started, so maybe this is the end of it. We are planning to sing again in 2 weeks, and the choir's looking forward to pulling that off. Again, we have probably some long-term or ongoing conflicts with some of our members and their parents and health problems. So that's pretty fragile at this point. So if you're interested in joining the choir, if you're interested in giving it a try, and you can sing harmony, please call Carolyn or myself. Carolyn's number's in the bulletin. You can find my number in the directory. And let us know. Now, I'm trying to think outside the box, trying to figure out, are there non-church members we could invite to be a part of it who would love to contribute to our community? I don't know how to do that. I'm not a big social media person. I can email, but I don't know. So some of the choir members who are capable of that will be looking into some of that. But be thinking about that. Is there a way that we could support the choir with that would allow us to survive on weekends when people have real life interruptions? I certainly want to express my thanks to the congregation for the great support over the years. I said it's the first time in 15 years. I don't think there's ever been a choir that came anywhere close to the life of this choir in the history of this congregation. So it's been quite an accomplishment. It's been a very rewarding experience, and I do hope it can continue. Please let us know if you're interested in singing in the choir.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. I'll say an amen to that because I'm a choir member. And I was going to be late last night, but I would have been here this morning, and all of us are choir members. And we fell down this time, but we're going to be back up. It's not over yet. And pray for us, and if you can sing, even if you can't sing, if you stand next to one of us, like Kyle, who sings well, and his wife and Roger, not so much myself, will teach you how to sing. So we're here this morning. We have a name for our group now. Bob, Raj, and the kids. These are the kids in between. But I tell you, they are phenomenal. They show up to rehearsal. They beat us there. Sometimes Lauren is eating, and when she doesn't eat, she's hard to deal with. But thank God we have been learning songs, and we're the ram in the thicket this morning. Now, what we usually do, they hit us with this last night, and we usually come in on Friday nights for a sound check. So if things are not just right, we may stop and start over again, because this song moves a little bit. Now, those of you in the audience who like to dance, keep it down, okay? Because we don't, but you can pat your feet, you can do whatever you want. But we're going to bring this off to you this morning. And we love you all. Pray for the choir. And like I said, I hear people all the time say, you know, I think I'd like to sing in the choir. Well, come on down. We'll learn you, okay? So if you want to clap your hands or whatever, here we go.
Let me tell you how I'm feeling. Tell you about a feeling, feeling that is real. Brother, let me tell you how the glory goes. Tell you how the bubbles in a happy soul. Happiness is reason and the thought of soul. Let me tell you how I'm feeling. Let me tell you. Well, there's a happy rhythm. It's a rockin' and a rollin'. I can feel it when I sing this song.
In me, deep within my soul, I can feel it rumble, I can feel it roll. Then I get the feeling that I want to shout. Makes me feel so good, I got a mood about. Rather than to never be a single down. Love the feeling, I can feel happy rhythm.
Well, there's a happy rhythm, rock and roll. I can feel it moving while I'm singing this song.
Within my soul, I can feel the rumble, I can feel it roll.
Then I get the feeling that I want to shout.
Makes me feel so good, I gotta move about. Brother, there can never be a single doubt. I can feel happy rhythm.
Well, there's a happy rhythm, keeps a rockin' and a rollin'. I can feel it movin' while I'm singin' this song. What a feelin', feelin' movin' on and never stoppin'. And my heart keeps a rollin' and a rockin', rollin' and a rockin' and a rockin' and a rollin'. It's a happy rhythm in my soul, in my soul.
Much guys, you saved the choir today. And yes, I like the name Bob, Roger, and the kids. Okay. By the way, thank you very much, Lauren and Kyle. It's a joy to see you here, and I'm glad to see you sitting together, loving each other still. I remember it will be 5 years ago, right? When these guys said I do to each other, and I had the privilege to officiate this wedding. Way to go, keep it up. Oh yes, I know. Oh really? Okay. Friends, my name is Pastor Julian Filipov. I have the privilege to be the lead pastor and also the preaching and teaching pastor of Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. For those of you who are here for the first time, you are in the middle of a series on the book of Genesis. And I would like to invite our team to play our bumper video, and then we are going to start with a sermon. Let's dim the lights, please. In his autobiography, Mahatma Gandhi published a very interesting story from his life. While he was a student in England pursuing his law degree, and this was a long time ago, 1888, between 1888 and 1891, Mahatma Gandhi was wondering what solution he can find for India. India has been segregated by different social castes, and he was looking for a way to unite his country. One day, as he was sitting in the library, he saw on a shelf a Bible. And he opened the Bible to the New Testament and started reading the Gospels. And by the time he was finished with the Gospel of John, he had an answer to his quest for the unity of his country. And his answer was Jesus. So Mahatma Gandhi, who was brought up as a Hindu, decided to become a Christian. And the very next Sunday, he went to a church. And as he entered the sanctuary of this church, the ushers quickly came to him and told him that this is a church where only white people worship, and he can go and worship with his own kind. But he is not welcome here. Mahatma Gandhi left this church and left Christianity because a handful Christians had a very distorted picture of the gospel and the purpose of the Bible. This small church in London closed the doors for one of the greatest sons of India. And with this closed door, they closed the opportunity for 1.5 billion people of India to get the best exposure to the gospel that no missionaries in the world would have been able to accomplish as well as Mahatma Gandhi could. The passage we are going to study today from the book of Genesis speaks about a topic and tells us the story that has become a fertile ground for a lot of wrong theological perceptions. So today, I would like us to explore those. And I've titled my message, When God Became Racist. Now that I have your attention, would you please grab your Bibles and open them with me to the book of Genesis chapter 9. And this will be the only text I would ask someone to read today. We're going to read the story and then I'm going to explore it. So Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 through 27. So if you feel prompted to read for us this text, lift up your hand and Dan is going to come to you with a microphone. So thank you, Sarah. Let's hear the word of God. Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 through 27.
The sons of Noah who came out of the boat with him were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These three men were Noah's sons, and all the people on earth came from these three sons. Noah became a farmer and planted a vineyard. When he drank wine made from his grapes, he became drunk and lay naked in his tent. Ham, the father of Canaan, looked at his naked father and told his brothers outside. Then Shem and Japheth got a coat, and carrying it on both of their shoulders, they walked backwards into the tent and covered their father. They turned their faces away so that they did not see their father's nakedness. Noah was sleeping because of the wine. When he woke up and learned what his youngest son Ham had done to him, he said, "May there be a curse on Canaan. May he be the lowest slave to his brothers." Noah also said, "May the Lord, the God of Shem, be praised. May Canaan be Shem's slave. May God give him more land to Japheth. May Japheth live in Shem's tents, and may Canaan be their slave."
Thank you, Sarah. The first thing that this story exposes us to is the drunkenness of Noah. Actually, this is the first hangover ever described in scriptures. There were many more to come, but this was the first one. Some people have had the tendency to excuse Mr. Noah, saying that he didn't know about fermentation because fermentation was a new thing that happened after the flood. Well, Jesus begs to disagree, because he says in Matthew chapter 24, verses 38, and then he continues and makes a connection with the last days in verse 49, that the people before the flood, they knew about drinking. He said they were eating and drinking. He didn't mean that they were drinking water, because in verse 49, he says, in the last days, people are going to be like that, and they're going to be drunkards. So people knew about alcohol. And what exactly here is happening is, Noah's folly has been left for us to learn a spiritual lesson. And here it is. Noah's failure proves that the victories of the past cannot protect us from the temptations of the present. As a matter of fact, the story of Noah tells us a story to all of us who have grown in years, and maybe in our youth we've been very strong Christians. Maybe we have been very upright men and women of God. And yet, the story of Noah teaches us that Noah was a strong spiritual man when he was surrounded by the ungodly. But when he was in the privacy of his tent, when he was in the privacy of his home, he fell. And the tendency of married parents and grandparents is to fall spiritually, exactly in their homes, exactly in the place where they have to stand upright more than any other place in this world. Now, in verse 22 we read, Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father. Here is what I'm going to do here. First, I'm going to give you some crazy interpretations of this text. And I didn't come up with those. They've been around for centuries and for millennia. And then I'm going to come at the end of this sermon with the craziest of all. So, do you see the highlighted words? Saw the nakedness of his father. This expression, seeing or uncovering the nakedness of someone, is a Hebrew idiomatic expression that is used in Leviticus chapter 18 and also in Leviticus chapter 20. And over there it's applied to gross sexual immorality. So when you see it there, it means not that uncovering someone's, you saw someone's penis, you actually saw more than that, you actually did something. And on basis of this text, of this connection, people throughout the ages, beginning with the Hebrew Jewish sages, they saw in the sin of Ham that he actually castrated, he emasculated his father, and this is why we don't see any more sons of Noah besides these three that came with him in the ark. Another interpretation that the rabbis throughout the ages have come up with is this one, that Ham slept with his mother, and as a result of this union, illicit union, Canaan was born, and this is why, even though Ham did the sinning, the curse was placed on Canaan. This is how they tried to explain why in the world Ham sinned, and yet the curse was placed on his son. And one last crazy interpretation, I'm not going to bother you too much with those. Ham, the last one, was involved in a homosexual act of raping his father. And this is why he is cursed. Now, these are the interpretations, and I don't know, I probably hope by now you sense from my voice I don't agree with those, right? Even though they make some kind of sense when you compare the Levitical texts with the story of Noah. But there is a problem. The Bible in Hebrew says it this way, verse 21. Noah uncovered himself in the tent. Why is this significant? Because many of the students of the Bible who make the connection between Leviticus 18 and the story of Ham and Noah miss one very important thing. Just for a minute, I'm going to bother you with a little bit of Hebrew grammar. In Hebrew, there are seven particular grammatical stems, and one of them is a reflexive stem, which is used in Genesis 9:21, Noah uncovered himself. Yet, in Leviticus 18, it's not used this reflexive stem, it's used a causative stem, which means, which has to be translated, Ham uncovered his father's nakedness. If this is what we read in Genesis, then these interpretations will stand, these crazy interpretations. But we do not have in Genesis 9:21, Ham uncovered his father's nakedness. Instead, we have Noah himself uncovered his own nakedness. Now, here are my reasonings why I cannot agree with these interpretations that are very popular, and chances are you go to another church, you're going to hear one of those crazy interpretations. And they'll sound so plausible only because people have not paid attention to their Hebrew Bible and what the Bible says actually in the original language. And a few more reasons, two more. Canaan was already born when Noah pronounced the curse on him. If you read verses 24 and 25, the moment Noah awakes from his drunken stupor, he pronounces immediately the curse over Canaan, which means that Canaan was already around. That means Cain cannot be the offspring of illicit sexual relationship between Mrs. Noor and Ham. And then, do you notice how the nakedness of Noah was covered? It was enough to put a cloth, a garment over his body, and his nakedness was covered. When you read the book of Leviticus, if we are talking about illicit sexual relationships, putting a blanket over Mr. Noah would not cover it. It involves a little bit more than that. I'm not going to go into details. Let's go back to our story. What actually happened? Why did Noah pronounce this curse on his grandson? So let's go back and explore it closely. Verse 22 says, Ham saw the nakedness of his father, and what did he do? What did he do? He went out and told his brothers. Actually, the Hebrew text is a little bit more exciting. It indicates that Ham went outside and he was gleeful. He was enjoying what happened. He was so happy that his father exposed himself. It reveals that Ham was bothered for a long time about his father's upright spiritual behavior. He didn't like that much this godly thing in his family. He wanted a little bit more fun. And probably he was convicted by the spiritual attitude of his father. He wanted a little bit more less spiritual father. He wanted someone who is a little bit more into partying. And the Bible tells us that he went outside excited about it. He wanted to share with his brothers, and he thought they're going to share the excitement. Yet his brothers did not share the excitement. Ham was rejoicing in the fall of his father. And I would like to tell you, of all the character traits of a person, this is probably one of the most demonic character traits. When you enjoy in the fall of other people, because then they're on your level. They're exactly the same miserable sinners like you. And you spread it all around so that everybody can know that they're exactly like you. Unfortunately, I know people in the churches and in some in our church who are like that. Enjoying when people fall. And let me tell you, this is the second insight from this story. How people respond to the moral fall of others is very revealing about their character. The character that Ham was revealing in this story was more offensive than even this gross sexual immorality that we talk about and we are so grossed about. Because there are very few who recover from this type of spiritual deformity. This is the very image of Satan. Satan has managed to project his image on the younger son of Noah. Now, what did his brothers do? Verse 23 says, but when Shem and Japheth took what? Did you see I put a word in capital and in yellow? When Shem and Japheth took what? A garment? The garment. This is why I emphasize it, because in your Bibles, the majority of the Bibles I checked in English, says they took a garment. This is not how the Hebrew text read it. The Hebrew text is very emphatic that they took their garment, which indicates that Ham not only saw his father naked, not only saw what's happening there, he took the very garment of his father and took it outside to show it to his brothers. See, he is drunk like a pig, and that's so funny, you have to see it. He's exactly like me, he's not better than me. Finally, I have it. He is a hypocrite. My father is a hypocrite. All these years, he was telling me not to drink with other bodies. Now, he's like me. He's like me. And what did Shem and Japheth do? They took the garment. They took the very garment of their father, put it on their shoulders, and walked backwards. And they covered the nakedness of their dad. Shem and Japheth covered the disgrace of their father. I know for us today it's difficult to imagine it. We see, oh, what's a big thing? I mean, saw him naked, oh, big deal. Back in this time and culture, it was a big deal. It was extremely big deal to see your parents or parent naked. So Shem and Japheth covered the disgrace of Noah. They were determined that this sin is going to stay in this tent, and it's not going to go anywhere. They were determined to cover the multitude of the failures of their father. Because Apostle Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, love covers multitudes of sin. Not that love shovels them under the rug, but love, true love, love that is prompted by God, does not expose other people's failure. Love that is coming from God does not rejoice when people are miserable and when they have fallen back into their old sin. True love does not go around and spread their failure. Do you know why? Because sinners who keep on falling in the same sin, if you spread their failures around, they start identifying themselves with their sin and they can never recover. Satan loves that. And next time, when you're so itchy to go and pick up the phone or go and tell someone about the miserable spiritual fall of this pastor or of this person or that person, be very careful what you're doing. Don't do the job of Satan. He's going to spread it around. You don't have to. Because wicked people rejoice in the moral failures of others. So here is the third insight. Maybe some of us here have had or still have fathers and mothers who are spiritual failures. And maybe you're tempted to go on the rooftop and tell everybody about what spiritual failure your mom and dad have been. Don't. Even when our parents do not act as honorably as God has called them to act, you still don't have the right to proclaim it from the rooftops. You don't have the right to embarrass them. As a true son of God, you have the responsibility to cover their nakedness and their shame. As a matter of fact, let me point out to something here. When Adam and Eve found themselves naked in the Garden of Eden, who covered them? They tried, but actually, who did really cover them? God Himself. He made them clothes of skin and He covered them. Here in this story, Shem and Japheth act like God. They reflect the character of God. They clothe the shame and the nakedness of the sinner. So next time, when you see someone wallowing in his own sins, and you feel so tempted to go and tell everybody else, ask yourself, are you acting like God or like the devil? Now, let's come to this really tricky question. Why was Canaan cursed for the sin of Ham? Because of this difficult question, this is why many of the rabbis have come with these crazy interpretations. And I gave you just three, there are more. Now, let's answer this question. Why was Canaan cursed for the sin of Ham? I don't know if you noticed, as we read this story, that every single time the name of Ham is mentioned, he's always introduced as Ham, the father of Canaan. Every time you read in the story, he's introduced as Ham, the father of Canaan. And this is a problem because he was not just the father of Canaan. According to chapter 10, verse 6, Ham was also the father of Cush, he was the father of Mitzrayim, which are the Egyptians, and he was the father of Put. But he was never introduced as the father of Mitzrayim, the father of Cush. He's always introduced as the father of Canaan. Because Ham was more than just physical father of Canaan, his youngest boy. Ham was also his spiritual father into wickedness. Like none of his other sons, this one picked the same character traits and fostered the same attitude. And later in the history of his children, you can see that reflected. Some of his children are those who lived in Sodom and Gomorrah, Admah and Zeboim. Some of his children are those that God commanded his children after waiting for several hundred years, said, wipe them out. They're absolutely reflection of the devil. So, here what I would like to tell you, friends. The sins that fathers participate in moderation. The sons will participate in excess. And since Canaan was the baby boy and probably the darling of the father, he spent more time to reflect and to model this image, this satanic image of mockery, of disrespect into his son Canaan. And this is why Noah, seeing this tendency of his son Ham, and seeing this tendency even more reflected in his son Canaan, he pronounced a prophecy what's going to happen in the future. That Canaan is going to become so degraded spiritually that there'll be no reason for him to exist as a nation. Now, let's come to the last point. I titled my sermon today, When God Became Racist. And I reserved the last interpretation, kind of the most egregious and outrageous interpretation of this text for last. For hundreds of years, this text in Genesis chapter 9 has been interpreted as a license to enslave the black people. So the story goes like that. Well, Ham was a white person before he sinned. But when he went to his father and did this disgraceful thing to him, and the father woke up, he cursed him, and in that very moment, the white Ham became a black person. And from that moment on, all the black persons are under a curse, they are condemned to be slaves, and they better agree with their role in human history, otherwise they are going against the will of God. This has been an interpretation perpetuated, this crime was perpetuated by Muslims. You can read it in Islamic literature, that black people supposedly because of Ham were less than the other people. You can read it in Jewish literature. Actually, the first ones to write about this subject were the Jewish sages, the Jewish rabbis around 500 AD in the Babylonian Talmud. I think it was in Sanhedrin, the tractate Sanhedrin, I think it's in portion 70. And then Christians in the Middle Ages, after they started practicing slavery and enslaving black people from Africa, they started using this text as justification for what they did. As a matter of fact, if you go online and you just Google arguments for slavery, during the time, let's say 1800s, you're going to see thousands upon thousands of pages that people in the South compiled in support of slavery. And the number one text that they were using is exactly the text of Genesis chapter 9. Now, let's sort this out biblically. On whom was the curse pronounced? Was it on Ham and all his descendants? On whom was the curse pronounced? Only one of his boys. And this was Canaan. Now, let's see how this prophecy was fulfilled. By the way, how many of you know any Canaanites today? You probably don't, because they were enslaved by several different nations, both descendants of Shem and descendants of Japheth, but they disappeared in the Third Punic War in 146 AD. That's it. They don't exist anymore. Now, let's explore this prophecy that Noah gave. Servants of what? Servants of what? Of servants. Just to ask you before we go to the Bible text, the Afro-American people, the African people who were brought to the United States as slaves, they were slaves. But were they slaves of slaves? Were the white people ever slaves? For the most part, no. To whom is this prophecy speaking that the descendants of Canaan were going to be servants of servants? When on several waves, the descendants of Canaan disappeared from the planet Earth because of their wickedness. The first wave were the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. The second wave was when the Israelites went in Canaan. And this is what happens when they came in Canaan. But when the inhabitants of Gibeon, which were Canaanites, heard what Joshua had done to Jericho and Ai, another Canaanite city, they worked craftily and went and pretended to be ambassadors. And they took old sacks on their donkeys, old wineskins torn and mended, old patch sandals, old bread. So they pretended they are coming from a country far, far away, not from Canaan, so that they can strike a covenant with the people of God and they'll not be destroyed. So, and this is what they say when they come to Joshua and the Israelites. We have come from a far away country. Now therefore make a covenant with us. So the people of Israel, they look at their clothes, they look at these guys really from far away. And this is what they did. So Joshua made peace with them and made a covenant with them. Then Joshua called for them. This is later, a few verses, because a few days later they traveled just 3 days and they discover, oh, these guys are neighbors. And they're Canaanites. And God told us to never make contract with these people. Well, then Joshua called for them and spoke to them, saying, why have you deceived us, saying, we are very far from you when you dwell near us? Now therefore, you are what? And none of you shall be freed from being slaves, woodcutters and water carriers for the house of my God. Were the Israelites slaves for 400 years in Egypt? They were. Now they, their slaves become the Canaanites. And thus the Canaanites become slaves of slaves. This is the fulfillment of the prophecy. Later on in the time of Solomon, in chapter 9 of 1 Kings, verses 20 to 22, he describes again a Canaanite tribe that he puts the burden on them to carry the water and the building material for the building of the temple. And as I told you, after 146, there are no more Canaanites. They're all either disappeared or they're so dispersed around the world that you cannot identify them as such. Now, to close this argument and to actually make my point, would you please open your Bibles with me to Numbers chapter 12? By the way, who wrote the book of Genesis? Who wrote this story about the sin of Ham? Moses. Okay. Let's open our Bibles to Numbers chapter 12. And I'm going to read first verse 1. Then Miriam and Aaron, these are the sister and the brother of Moses, then Miriam and Aaron spoke again Moses because of, in some of your Bible says, Ethiopian woman. In the original text says Cushite, which means black, dark-skinned woman. Because he married a dark-skinned woman, for he had married a Cushite woman. Why were Aaron and Miriam objecting? Why didn't they like their brother? What happened? He married a black lady. Wait a minute. Who wrote the story of Genesis chapter 9? Moses. And he knew nothing about this curse of Ham and all the black people, right? He obviously didn't know anything about it because he marries a dark-skinned woman. Now let's keep on reading. So they said, has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also? And the Lord heard it. Now, the man Moses was very humble, more than all men who were on the face of the earth. He must be. I mean, his own brother and sister treat him like crap. And they tell him, you married someone that you should not marry. You don't know any better. This is not the will of God. You know better. Suddenly, verse 4, the Lord said to Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, come out, you three, to the tabernacle of meeting. So the three came out. Then the Lord came down in the pillar of cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both went forward. So they were called into the principal office. And God tells them, now let me tell you something about Moses. And then in the next verses, you can read them if you want. I'm going to paraphrase them. You think you know better? You think that you are, because you are prophets, because both of them had visions, you are better than Moses? Moses is very special to me, God says. He's a person I speak face to face. He's the highest of all people on this earth. With no one I speak face to face, but with Moses. And then listen to what he says in verse 9 and 10. So the anger of the Lord was aroused against them. Does it say the anger of the Lord was aroused against Moses because he married one of those people that are supposedly cursed? Does it say it? Now let's read verse 10. And then the cloud departed from above the tabernacle. Suddenly Miriam became leprous, as white as snow. Then Aaron turned toward Miriam, and there she was, leprous, white as snow. Let me translate to you what God said to Miriam. You think you're superior because of your lighter skin? I'm going to give you lighter skin. And she became leprous, white as snow. Did God make a statement? I think so. Now, why did the people during the Middle Ages and people in America came with the idea that this text in Genesis 9 talks in favor of their prejudices? Why? Do you know what, friends? Here it is. I'm going to put it on the screen. This is the last insight for today. God made us in His own image. But every single time we allow prejudices to blind our spiritual eyesight, we start making God look like us. We start making God in our own image. And this is what I'm trying to tell you. Our culture changes us. And before you jump to the conclusion and you say, oh, if I lived in the time of this white, mean people who interpret so meanly the Bible, I would have been different. Hold your horses. Will you? It's a very, very sneaky thing that culture does on us, friends. Oftentimes, culture permeates us and changes us. Our upbringing changes us and makes us have these blind spots in our vision. And we start perceiving God as racist because we are racist. We start perceiving God as prejudice because we are prejudice. Any prejudice you nurture in your heart, any, distorts the image of God in you. And any distortion of the image of God creates a gospel that bars some of God's children out of the kingdom. So, is your theology being shaped by your culture or by Christ? It is easy to look back at what these people in the past did wrong. I'm asking you to look at us today. Is our culture shaping us? Racism is one of the most powerful tools that Satan has invented to separate us and to control us. And he has done a marvelous job, you can see it. I was watching the news on our media for the last several years. And boy, I can see how Satan is trying to divide us as a nation again because of our ethnic and cultural differences. And I'm not saying because of our racial differences, because I don't like this expression. Do you know that the Bible does not speak of different races? The Bible speaks only of one race, human race. The idea that people with different skin color of different races came for the first time through the theory of evolution. Before that, in the English language, the word race was used this way. The English race, the Irish race, the German race. It was describing people's groups. But since the time of the theory of evolution, the expression race applied to skin color became a medium to which Nazism came into being, where one particular people group was considered smarter and better than another group. But the Bible speaks of only one race, the human race. Satan is trying for the last several years to divide our country. And boy, as I was reading a few months ago, some of the sermons and quotations from Martin Luther King Jr., Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. And I was thinking to myself, if somehow miraculously this guy is resurrected and brought to life and see what our country is doing today, trying through force and through killing on the point of bayonet and with guns to solve these ethnic tensions, he will die again. Friends, Jesus has created us as brothers and sisters. We are going to live in heaven together. And he asks us to start living as brothers and sisters here and now. If there is any place that can show the world how these ethnic tensions can be resolved, it is the church. And I would like to ask you on behalf of God, let's men and women up, let's Christian up, and let's live to the high standards that God has called us to live. To conclude with this thought of Mahatma Gandhi, one of the brightest sons of India, who was barred from Christianity because of the prejudices and racist views, theological views, of some narrow-minded Christians in England. This is how he says it at the end of his life. I like the New Testament. I like your Jesus. But I don't like you, Christians. And what he meant is, he does not like these Christians whose theology and worldview is shaped by their culture, whose theology and worldview is distorted by a picture they have created of God that bars people from the kingdom of heaven. And I hope today will make the decision to deal with our prejudices, to get on our knees, to deal with this as long as it takes, but to not allow prejudices to rule and control his church, because this is the place where he wants to show the world that it can work. That it doesn't matter what your social economic status is, it doesn't matter what your skin color is, it doesn't matter what your culture is. Together, we can be brothers and sisters of Christ because we are created of the same blood. Would you please take out of your bulletin the yellow connection card? Let's turn it to the back and please check at least one of these decision steps I will suggest. First, I want to be a parent, a grandparent, who is easy to honor and to obey. Second, since our prejudices render us incapable of seeing people as children of God, I will pray daily so that I can see people through the eyes of Jesus. And finally, Lord, while our culture shapes our worldview more than we care to admit, I beg you not to let it shape my view of you. May God bless us all.
What a wonderful challenge to us as so-called Christians. May we stand together and sing hymn 338, Redeemed by the Blood of the Lamb.
His mouth and exclaimed, "In truth, I perceive now that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, among all people, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving us so much. Thank you so much that even through the dark ages of Christianity, when we have allowed atrocities to happen in your name, you still have not given up on your church. Would you please help us to live up to your high expectations for us and help us to model for the United States and for the whole world what it means to live together as brothers and sisters, in spite of our differences, in spite of our socio-economical discrepancies, and in spite of our different cultures and different skin hues. In the name of your Son, we pray. And all the people of God said together, Amen.